Hell yeah, Kings. All feeling ready? Let's dive in here.
Sir.
Episode 56. Right. I'm here with Born Anew, first full band all the way in the basement by yourselves. Appreciate you guys coming through. Thanks for making the trip up. Thank you for having me. Before we dive into all the fun stuff here, I want to give you guys a chance to plug anything we have coming up. So I know we got a new single out. I assume there's some new stuff cooking, maybe some shows happening. Yeah, is there anything coming up that we want to make people aware of or anything recently released that we want to remind people of?
Yeah, we just put out our first new single since I joined the band on November 24th. It's called Seoul City. We just finished working on a new music video yesterday. We're excited to like really start pumping out the content for everybody. I know that they're hungry for it, but new single just dropped in November, and that's the main thing that's happened recently with us. Other than that, we've just been working behind the scenes and trying to get everything prepared properly at the end of the day.
Classic band life, staying busy while everything seems silent, and it's like, no, we've been working harder than ever,
non-stop.
But we just can't talk about it yet, can't quite make it public. Hell yeah, dude. I want to chat with Seoul City right ahead. So Seoul City's out. It's been out for a month-ish, 2 months, a month, somewhere in there.
It dropped in November, so.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, a little over a month now.
Hell yeah. Where was that filmed? It looked like it was in someone's house. Was it like a rented space? Was it actually one of your houses? Like, where the hell was that?
So we actually filmed it in the same same location that we filmed Rat in the Room.
Hell yeah.
It's in Philadelphia. It's called The Reservoir. I feel like it's a pretty known place. A lot of people have similar sets. So it was kind of like a challenge for us to go in there, have already shot in a video there, you know, and, you know, we really wanted to make sure that it didn't look the same.
That's always a challenge.
But, you know, we were really happy with it. We worked with Nick Chance on that.
Shout out.
Shout out him. You know, he's been a longtime friend of ours for a very long time. So we always appreciate his time, you know, with his busy schedule now. We were very happy with how the video came out. We have Alex Taylor from Malevolence featuring on the track as well.
Heavy as hell.
Also in the video as well. So if you haven't checked the video out, definitely worth doing so.
Yes.
Very happy about the song. Kind of is a perfect song for us to come back after not having released music.
Why is that?
I think it's very similar to the Born Anew sound.
Yeah.
That everyone kind of like fell in love with, or, you know, found us with, essentially, you know, over the last couple of years. And we really wanted to, you know, showcase James, the new vocalist, with something that the people were familiar with.
Yep.
And I think we did just that, you know.
That must be the hardest challenge to balance, like, how much of James do we go? Because I'm sure, James, you got your own two cents happening in here, but you don't want to come in and rock the boat immediately. Like, you want to come in and, like, continue what Born Anew is, but you don't want to do that in a way that, like, makes you feel bored in what you're doing. Like, you want to,
We definitely didn't want to alienate the fans in that aspect, because it coming in as a new vocalist, like, it's obviously very hard knowing that I'm going to have people that are expecting a certain thing or are used to the traditional formula that was presented in the past. Being able to see the reception and see that people are taking to it and accepting it in the long run is very, very positive to see. And it makes me feel very, very good about it overall.
Soul City is James's first recorded track music ever video ever out. With a band ever. So
that's a great first place to start. That's way better. I don't know what y'all's first songs are, but I'm sure they weren't that good.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm sure we started a little humbler. Hell yeah. Joining a band seems so strange it seems so challenging to me, because for me, like, when I'm coming into a video, like, it's a similar thing. If I'm joining the band for a certain amount of time and it's about creating something that, like, extends the legacy of the band. But for me, it's like they almost want me to rock the boat. They want me and the videographer to come in and, like, do something that the band hasn't seen before. Whereas on the vocalist side, it's like you're trying to come in and do the exact opposite of that.
Yes,
where for me, I enjoy the process of, like, getting to join a new camp for a week or two at a time. And you have, a similar challenge, but you can't rock the boat as much. Whereas for me, it's encouraged to go in and, like, do something cool. Do something you haven't seen before. And that seems like a real hard balance to find. For you guys, was it, like, different writing the song? Were you, like, writing it with James in mind? Was the song written before James?
It was written with, like, Toast on the record originally.
Okay.
Because the record's been done for almost 2 years.
As band stuff does.
So, you know, in the process of James hopping in, we took out songs and then rewrote a few and then added completely new ones. Soul City was one of the older ones that just the only thing that, you know, changed was James's vocals.
Gotcha.
So it's been there for a while.
Gotcha.
And it's definitely, like, one of the heavier ones, which is why it was released first.
Yeah.
Going back to what Saxz said regarding, like, you know, wanting to keep the old stuff kind of fresh.
Yep.
while keeping the newer stuff away for now.
Keep people engaged. I also want to touch on like the TVs behind you guys. Were those like practical TVs? It didn't look like green screen. It looked like you were in front of four or six, eight TVs, but it seems like finding matching TVs would be a fucking disaster.
Is this also included in the set? We kind of just got lucky. Yeah. The guy, Kurt, he works the Reservoir.
Yep.
And he has so many different sets in that building, so many different lights, different props. And one of the things that he had recently gotten was eight TVs. Literally just probably bought, went into the store, I imagine, and just bought eight of these same TV because they were exactly the same.
That's it, yeah.
Four, you know, 4x2.
Yep.
And yeah, we had it hooked up with the HDMI. We had pre-made footage. We took a lot of my baby footage from when I was a child.
I was going to ask if that was your baby footage, and I was hoping I was right, but if I'm wrong, then it's a real terrible question to ask someone.
Yeah, like, low-key, it could have been just random stock footage, but, like...
It would have been weird to use a random family's baby footage. I feel like that'd be kind of weird.
Yeah, dude. So we did some digging, and we found some footage of me as a kid to really, like, make it organic. But yeah, those TVs were all there, just happened to be there, and we kind of worked it into the music video. You know, we didn't plan on shooting with that in mind, so.
It worked out well with the footage. Yeah, where did that footage idea come from? There's also in the video looking through pictures, so I assume it's tied to like, yeah, childhood, looking through the growth of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, Seoul City is just about the questions I personally have, being adopted as a kid, as a young age. So, you know, we were like, how can we make this feel heartfelt, but like still like have that, you know, edge of a music video where it's not just like this documentary style, like, okay, as a young kid, you know, this is his story. So we just felt the easiest way to tell that story was with the organic stuff that we could find from my past, you know, photos of me as a kid, footage of me as a kid, and just kind of sprinkling it throughout the video rather than making it a huge focus. So it was nice to have those TVs in the back, and then there was the other living room set where there was a older TV. Kind of like that whole concept kind of just naturally came together. It was really cool, you know? Because to be honest, we really didn't have too many ideas for the video. We kind of gave Nick Chance full creative power. And yeah, you know, everything kind of just lined up for that one.
Hell yeah.
And for that shot.
It was fun to watch it. As you were talking about the different, having a random kid in the video, for Christmas, I went through my family's like VHS tapes and like digitized them and gave it to them on a flash drive or whatever. One of that was going through my sister's dance recitals. So there's a weekend where I'm sitting there for hours watching old kids' dance recitals, look like zooming on everyone, like, is that my sister? I don't think so. Move on to the next one. And it was literally 12 hours of me watching six-year-olds dance. And it was the craziest shit ever. And it felt so horrible. And I was like, thank God I live here alone. Because if anyone else walked in this room and saw me, like, investigating old dance recitals from 2000, like,
yeah, for like an entire day on end.
The perfect stand-up bit if I've ever fucking heard. Literally. Holy shit.
Literally.
You're going to get a knock on your door, and it's going to be Chris Hansen.
I was so scared of that fucking knock. It's like, no, this is for my family. It's for good. It's for love. But that's the problem you guys are trying to avoid, right? It's trying to find whose kid do we put on TV.
I mean, it just makes sense that it was Saxz because the song's about him.
Yeah.
I just think in general it'd be like weird, you know, like in theory, I guess if you're using stock footage, I guess that's like a normal thing in like the video world.
But even then, I still feel like it feels weird. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah,
it kind of got to the point where I was digging for photos and digging for this footage. And if we couldn't come up with it, we would have shifted the whole kind of like idea, made it a little bit less personable because there would have been no way to like tie this random footage or random picture and be like, this was him, you know?
Find some two-year-old who looks like you.
It's crazy. Exactly. Like, originally, though, we wanted to find the actual footage of me, like, coming off the plane, you know, the moment that I, like, went into my parents' arms kind of thing. But
it's crazy.
Deep.
That exists?
It's deep. Yeah, I have never seen it.
Wow.
Even to this day.
Okay.
But it's deep. It's somewhere.
Yeah.
You know? They got to dig it out. For sure.
I'm excited. I hope that gets dug out someday. It feels like a real cool like trophy to find.
But honestly, because I haven't been able to see that, putting this video out is like the next best thing. You know, like a bunch of people have reached out and said like, yo, it was sick to hear your story. Some people even like have related to it in other ways. You know, it's cool to see.
Yeah.
You know, for the message to like actually get out there. And for people to be like, okay, I get it. Now our job as like telling that story, putting this visual together, all that, the reward, like the comeback is like all there.
Yeah.
So yeah, overall, like, doesn't matter about the views, doesn't matter about the streams, bro. Like, we were happy to put that song out.
Hell yeah.
You know, James, as his debut, my storytelling, and just honestly 2 years of just not putting music out.
Yes.
We did that shit for ourselves, you know?
That's so. What it's got to be like. Yeah. I want to go back to the start of this. Yeah. So we're that's the fun beginning of where we are currently. But yeah, let's set the scene here a little bit. I'm looking at you three here. Where does Born to Start? I assume you guys are the three founding members, and James comes in more recently. Are y'all three founding?
I mean, Chip, I'll let you handle that because technically, he's the only
OG. I started the band in 2013.
Oh, 11 years ago.
With like a completely different group of dudes.
Was it like sonically similar?
Kinda. I wanted to be in a band that played breakdowns, essentially, is how it went. Like, I'll be straight. Yeah. It didn't matter. Like, I wanted to like go on Warped Tour.
Yep.
Synchronized moves.
Yeah, like, and so I had a bunch of other guys in it that you know, still friends with most of them. One of them was in college and wanted to do real life things, and then another one.
How dare he?
Yeah. Well, you know, and the other one, it just wasn't working out. Yeah. And Saxz then joined literally in 2014.
Okay.
So, you know, when I count, like, I guess if you count OGs, like original members, I would count Saxz as that too. And then, you know, we had our old vocalist Toast, who then came in to play as bass originally, and we had our old vocalist Alex. And it kind of like grew from there, started doing some small tours, and then Pinder joined. Yeah, shortly after,
2016.
Yeah. And then it was kind of us five, and then we thankfully got rid of our old vocalist, and then Toast moved to vocals, and then that became the four piece, which is what it was for years.
Hell yeah. Okay.
And honestly, he's kind of making it seem like it was this like smooth buttery trail of like just people coming in and out, but like I was lucky to even find Chip, you know, like my old band from Northern Jersey. Had no ins with any promoters, didn't know what we were doing, just wanted to do it. Yeah. And we played an open showcase in Northern Jersey, and Born Anew was on the bill. And I saw like the stage presence and the energy that they brought, and kind of similar thing. All my guys in my band at the time wanted to do real life things.
Yep.
So I hit up Chip one day and was just like, yo, if you ever need a drummer to fill in, I'm your guy. And he was like, kind of do. So, yeah. And from there, kind of like, it just kind of happened like organically. I joined, and you know, for a while, me and Chip were both doing a lot of business together, you know, getting shows, building the brand, getting us out. But for a while, like, everyone's comment after seeing us live, yo, you guys would sound sick with a bassist. Yo, you guys need a bassist. Yo, you guys can't play metal without a bassist.
Yeah.
You know, and after a while, we were like, maybe it's time. Like, we just need to find someone for that low end, you know, hold it down. And our producer that we've been working with for a long time, Randy, he mentioned this random ass name, Kyle Pinder, one day.
I know that guy.
Yeah.
And you know, I can say personally, I was very against it at the time.
We actually all said no.
Yeah, didn't have any bass experience.
Like, you didn't want a bass player, or
there's a few things when you go in.
I was also never in a band before.
When you when you go to look at a new band member and you like do the deep dive on like an Instagram, everyone in a band does it, and you just like look at a guy and you're like, ah, yeah, this guy's got it.
Yeah.
And then you look at Pinder, and it was like him wearing like a very tight Rise Records shirt and playing a like Moss.
Sounds like my kind of guy.
I mean, playing a Moss, that was my thing, like Moss the Flames bass part.
Yeah. And it was kind of just like
all opens, you know, like we didn't know if he could play bass or if he was just like rocking it. Like,
it was like, like a breakdown in GNF, which is like sick, but it was like, maybe.
And then
we
were like,
else.
Yo, send us one more video. It's Woe Is Me's breakdown. It's like, all right, dude, like, this is all the same thing. Like, and our producer was like, nah, dude, give him a chance. Like, you don't know until you know. Like,
yeah.
And I was like, you're right. Like, we absolutely don't know anything about this guy. And here we are saying, like, no, he's not the guy. Like, you know, sure enough.
And then, yep.
It works out.
Well, also, it was just through mutual friends, too, because I was already with everybody down in, like, the South Jersey scene back in the day. So I ended up meeting them through mutual friends. So it just kind of linked over time. And it was just...
It's funny because he was actually a
fan. I was
a fan.
I went to their first EP release show and bought a t-shirt and EP from him.
Hell yeah.
And I don't remember at all.
Yeah, that's great.
And there's like videos...
You remember everyone you sell shirts. Don't say that.
There's like videos of Pin like front row, like during our set, during Ryan's old band Premonition set. Like,
that's sick.
Just as a fan. So it's crazy to see that full circle sometimes, you know?
Yeah. And you said you joined in 2016. So yeah, when you joined Born Anew, is it still like a local band? You guys started to like grow out of Jersey? Like,
they did their first tour with this with another band that our old vocalist was in, Premonitions.
Okay.
And so they did a tour with them, two bands, one van. And then after that, they had another tour lined up. And that's the tour I filled in on. It was like a week-long tour.
Okay.
And then basically after that, I was told I was going to become a member, and then we just became a thing after that, basically.
Yeah, but you weren't asked to become a member. You were told you
were going
to become
a member. It was like kind
of funny. It took a while, though. I had to hold the literal lights for a promo shoot on that tour, filling in for them for.
Which, at the end of the photo shoot, though, we did do, like, a promo set with him in it. For, like, the announcement. But we were like, yo, we need to, like, post something. So we, like, we're like, yo, can you, like, hold the light? And he did hold the light.
I did. Which, I was like, hey, can you come on tour and play bass for us? But you also got to hold the light for our photo shoot.
One of those, like, low-key where, like, it's shitty, but also, like, that's how you know it was going to work, right? Like, you want the guy who's like, yes, I'll hold the light. Whatever you need, I'm going to make that happen for you guys. And I think that's part of being in a band is, like, yeah, you guys all have your instruments and your trades, but, like, it's more about being a team and being like, yeah, who merch needs to get set up. I'm going to go do it. I have time.
Yeah.
And in the context of this, it's like, yeah, you needed someone. It sounds like you guys needed someone who's going to say yes to holding the light, who's just going to say yes to supporting and being helpful. And, like, yeah, not that holding the light was why you brought him on tour, but, yeah. Like, it's the same energy that you want in your camp.
And crazy thing about that is first band, first show on the tour ever that he played.
I never
played
in a local band. I never played a local show.
Damn. So we were just, like, playing in your room? Like,
yeah,
like
so, like, I played, like, ice hockey my whole life. Yeah. And then, like, I was going to go to college, but then, like, I chose not to. So then I basically just – I've always been into music. I was always a Warped Tour kid, all that kind of stuff. So I was, like, bored. I needed something to do. So I was like, let me teach myself bass.
That's more or less how I got into camera stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. So then basically over time for a few years, I just kept doing my own thing every day after work, going home, sitting in the room, just looking at stupid stuff, learning how to play, like – learning everything. And then eventually it just, I was like, all right, now I'll post videos because, like, whatever, I have nothing else to do. So then at that rate, it just became, you know, and I never even knew that Randy was a big reason as to why I was even asked to fill in the first place until afterwards too. Yep. So it was just crazy. And, like, I have the utmost respect for Randy because, like, without him, I wouldn't be here. It's literally
that butterfly effect is always so crazy.
Exactly. Yeah. So it is crazy to think about sometimes and, like, how involved he is in our process and, like, just how he's always been a good friend and mentor for us along the way all these years.
I feel like every band has a, like, unwritten member of someone who's not in the promos, but someone who's behind the scenes who pushes a lot of the buttons.
100%.
Yeah. 100% influential and shit. Yeah.
Yeah, we've worked with Randy since, like, our first single, like, officially came out called Gift. That was the first song he wrote with us. And it was, like, a sticky process too, because, like, Saxz brought up Randy originally to, like, work with, and he was like, yo, like, he songwrites, he does this, and I was like, no.
Who did you say yes to ever in this process?
To be honest, it took a while.
It
sounds like everything is like, yo, Chip, how about we do this cool thing? And you're like, pump the brakes, brother.
Yeah. Let me tell you something, though. Like, so, all right, we learned that when you jump the gun and say yes to things with this band within the past year, we've tried out members. Yep. We've tried this. And I'm not going to lie. These are times where I actually, like, let the gas go, dude. I was like, go. And let me tell you, dude, no.
Yeah.
It ended up, like, kind of proving why, like, it is, like, what you were just saying, like, joining a band is hard, man. And it was different when Pinder joined. We were essentially a local band trying to tour.
Yeah.
Then you add Pinder in and now go 8 years later where us three have become unified. Now James has to join that unified part. And it's hard, man. Yeah. It's really hard. And it's hard for us to welcome a new person in. And we learn that it's not always how it might be, how you think it might be.
Yeah.
And, like, that's why, you know, working with Randy was a blessing where eventually, you know, it took arguments. And I learned that he wasn't a ghostwriter. I thought that was my interpretation. I thought he was going to write our music for us, and it was just, I'm going to, like, take the high road. But it wasn't. He writes with. So ever since that day, though, like, every song I write, everything that we write as a band, like, goes to Randy. And me and Randy dissect and write. And it really has made me a better songwriter.
He is definitely our unspoken member of the band, for sure.
Like, we've, you know, I give a lot of credit to Randy for pretty much everything. And, you know, it's a challenge, too, because, like, you know, originally it was, like, me trying to write songs and then be like, hey, I need your help, Randy. Now it's, like, my goal, I will always work with him. Like, that's, like, one of my, like, personal things. Like, I'm keeping this guy with us. And But like, I try and write these songs now to where it's like, yo, I don't need this guy, bro. Like, I screw it. Like, yeah. I can write the whole thing by myself. And it never is the case.
Yeah.
But now my songwriting has just kept growing because of him. Mm-hmm. And he's a big part of that.
Hell yeah.
And he's just a big asset. Like, you know, without him, we wouldn't have Pinder. He's a guy whose opinion matters to us, that's in our camp, but a lot of people don't know that he's in our camp. Yep. You know what I mean?
And James, can I get your 2 cents here on then joining the band? Or you kind of heard from their end that it's tough to welcome someone in. They've got a culture lined up. They've got just a way of life. And I feel like that's like, we talk about the big stuff here in terms of like writing styles, but it's also like, where do you stop on the road at night? Like, do you need to eat a different restaurant? Are you, it's all the same like dietary
Luckily,
goals here. Like,
James is very similar with the tour aspect.
Literally. Like, we are all very cooperative with one another in the fact that we can have a discussion, say what we don't like and what we do like, and then we work from there.
Yeah.
One of my major things coming into the band is changing up sound a little bit. That was one of my major foot forwards that I wanted to put. Mm-hmm. And it took a lot of battling, I cannot lie, but thankfully, like, we all came to the conclusion, like, maybe traveling towards a new direction or adding some different flavors that were not there before could benefit us. And honestly, the new record, it's everything that we could have asked for at the end of the day. So, I mean, I think that we are doing the best possible job that we could be at the cooperative process. Mm-hmm. But we always have our bumps in the roads, like anybody does.
As bands do. James, can we just slide in just a tiny bit, and then we'll be good. Hell yeah. So then 2016 is when you come into the band, Pinder. At 2016, we're kind of a local band working to leave Jersey. Like, what are we doing in 2016? What's happening here?
So, yeah, like,
2016, we were kind of just doing DIY tours.
Okay. Yeah,
we
it was like very DIY. You did most of the booking.
Yeah, I did essentially all our booking up until like 2017.
Okay.
So our goal was just to, you know, at the time, I'd like to say this too, 2016, totally different time. Bands were not just getting in their van and touring. You know, young bands were not just booking their own tours. Like, you had some bands that did it. You know, obviously, sure. There's always been DIY grinders. You know, it's nothing new, but you know, it took us a lot to really just be like, yo, let's do this.
Yep.
And we kind of took that mindset and just ran with it. We went, you know, 2 years with just straight DIY touring, trying to be on the road essentially every other month. The time home was just enough money for us to save money for us to be back out.
Yeah.
And in hopes that, you know, bigger things would come and the reward would be there. So yeah, 2016, you know, Pin joins and we're moving. We have a couple DIY tours under our belt, and you know, now we see the full potential because now we have a full lineup.
Yes. And what does DIY mean to you? Like, are we talking like house shows, basements? Are we talking like DIY in terms of booking yourself?
DIY.
It's funny, we literally talked about this the other day.
Some people just say DIY, and I feel like they don't even know what it means. But for me, I literally say like, do it yourself.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, like, it, whether that means a house or a show or this or that, like, you could DIY anything.
Yeah.
So yeah, like essentially no management, no label, no agent.
I want to say that it went down to the detail with him booking it, where he booked our full US, like a full month long, full country US tour, booked all of that.
First one.
Then booked all of the locals on those shows.
Jesus.
Because it's his way. He knew all the bands. He was learning about the scenes from each state, which helped us too. Because when we show up, he was finding the better local bands, the better bands that are sick, the bands that are our style too, our stature, the same ones that are trying to tour.
Trying to spread that like unified feeling, like you were saying, within the band to bands now, like bands with bands, you know, like creating like this group of bands that we agree, like we believe in as well, and that we can all kind of come up together, essentially.
Yeah. And also people you want to hang out
but
with.
But I'm not going to lie, you know, with booking DIY at a young age, like I ran into a lot of problems. I tried to cut corners here and there. I pissed off some people.
I'm sure.
Probably didn't handle business correctly. A lot of Facebook messages. You know, and even with the bands, you know, I had promoters come back and say, like, you're booking the show with me. Like, what is my job then? Mm-hmm. You know, like, I've actually never had someone come to me and say, these are the bands we want. So, you know, I learned from that, you know, and moving forward, I think it was cool that we were able to kind of be a little pushy and do it our way, but then learn how it all kind of like will come full circle and be like, okay, maybe this isn't the right way to do it, but you have the right idea.
Yep.
And from there, we were able to grow, you know?
As you reflect on those, I'm interested, you kind of alluded to things not going well. And so I'll,
100%,
I'm curious of one of the, one time where things didn't go well. In my example here, always, in the context of like booking and kind of being pushy with people. When I first get into shooting shows, I'm photographing shows primarily, and I'm photographing 3 or 4 shows a week. Like I did 100 shows my first year, which is something that like I...
Crazy
in hindsight. Congrats. To look back.
That's
like,
crazy.
And it wasn't 100 times that people said, hey, come do this. It was 99 times of me being like, I'm going to go do that. And then maybe one time, so it's, hey, come to the show.
Yeah.
Right? And so at that thing, it was, how do I get my name out? And part of that was going to shows. And then it's like, well, now that I'm at the shows, I've taken the photos. Like, how do I make people see the photos? There's 2,000 people at the Palladium. How do I get them to my Instagram? And so to me, it was business cards. I printed out business cards, like my social media on them. And I would bring stacks and like fucking thousands of these things to the show.
Yeah.
And my mentality was always like, no one is leaving here without talking to me and without getting one of these things. And in certain, I guess the good part of that was like, I did get to go around. I met a lot of people. I met a lot of bands I'm still working with now. And I think in the context of like people at the venue, it's like, I knew that if you're at the front row at the Palladium, like you might not look at my business card now, but if every time you're at the Palladium, I am also there. I'm saying, hey, I took photos. Like eventually you're going to go look at these photos and this thing will trickle. The flip side there is like, I'm sure I pissed off a lot of motherfucking people, right? Like, I was just walking up to anyone I could see and going, hi, sorry to interrupt. My name is Peter. I'm taking photos tonight. If you want to see, here's where you can see. And kind of to your point, talking about, like, looking at the bookers and, like, worrying about stepping on toes because you kind of booked the show. It seems like a similar thing to me where it's like, I attribute a lot of my momentum to that, to going literally door to door, for lack of a better term, at people and being like, I am Peter. But it sounds like you probably ran into some similar adversity with booking the show thing where it's like, there was a lot of good, but is there a time looking back where you're like, oh fuck, I shouldn't have handed out business cards to everyone?
Honestly, when I look back at it, like, I just look at it with like, it's different with like context.
Yeah.
You know, when you're new and you're this young guy, I'd like to think that when you are messing up and someone's correcting you, it's more just constructive criticism and it's for you to like figure it out, you know?
Yep.
So I think without making wrong moves, you're not gonna figure out which moves are the right ones, you know? So I think striking out with certain promoters or maybe not handling an email the right way or whatever it may have been, you know, definitely didn't do it again, you know? So that's kind of the biggest thing there.
Yeah.
Nothing that was like detrimental to the band, but more so just us being young and hungry, you know,
and willing to take a chance, I think, is the other piece. I think we're all desperate for our art, but it's like, are you willing to book? Are you willing to reach out to all these local bands in the scene, figure out who the good local bands are in fucking Wyoming or wherever like bullshit state you had to stop it on the way to like the good place? Like, I'm sure it was easy to find LA locals, but I'm sure it's some of the South Dakotas or wherever. It was like, and you're the guy who's in charge of trying to find the good band there so that that show can go off without a hitch and be a place that you guys can look forward to like ending up in.
Instead
of being just the middle of nowhere that you're stuck in. Hell yeah. So when it started to become real, so this is kind of our local touring, full national tour. It sounds like that's real, but it sounds like there's still another step of like legitimacy that can be gained here. Like, when does this thing start to gain momentum from Saxz booking stuff to things happening more organically or more, I don't know, opportunities coming from the outside?
I mean, first off, just getting sick of renting a van. That's one thing. So
the first few tours we just rented from Green Vans. And we saw how much money it really was with how frequent we wanted to be out. So that was definitely one.
It was definitely like the first real thing we needed to like do to be like, all right, we can do this constantly now, because like if we buy it, we own it, and then like we just take care of it. So once we were able to solidify owning a van, then we were able to be more, you know, go to go and get on the road and everything like that. So I think from there on, I think your booking and the shows that we played, honestly, was a big part of getting involved in all those separate scenes around the country, even just regionally, you know, in the Northeast and the South, like just gaining, knowing people and playing the shows. And then over time, you know, people just post videos, people see stuff over time, and it's like, it just can build to something as long as you just keep trying to do it.
It's pretty crazy because like throughout all that time of us doing that touring, we were kind of trying to find like our own identity still. So I wouldn't even be able to say, like you're saying, when did this become real? You know, Ryan went from bass to guitar to vocals. And before he was our vocalist, you know, we had 3 fill-ins, Eduardo, Moke, even from Lorna filled in for a show, you know, like we were just calling in homies just to fill in for a show. And we finally landed with our one good friend, Steven Mannix, And he filled in and held it down for a very long time. But it was really hard to like push the band and like grow when it was like, this isn't our guy, but we're just kind of like, you know, maybe, who knows? And, you know, when Ryan became the vocalist, it was, I think, what, 2018, the beginning?
2017. January 1st, we announced
That's when things started to get, like, real. Because we saw the promos of us four. We were, like, four-piece. Everyone's rocking. We have our members solidified. And, you know, we had all of that steam from doing those DIY tours to where now there was a demand for the next move. So the path kind of, like, lit up as we were moving, like, by itself. And we kind of knew what we needed to do next, and I was just like, put out a banger record.
Yep.
And then, you know, with that comes, you know, do we want management? Do we want this? And, you know, we worked with plenty of managements through those years of even DIY, like kind of in and out, like loosely with people, just to get advice and stuff. Mm-hmm. And we quickly learned about, you know, what the do's and don'ts are with, you know, certain managers and certain agents and just kind of how like certain people conduct business.
Yeah.
You know, what we want for ourselves, you know, we kind of know what we want. So, you know, we started to mess around with some people and didn't really land on anyone until Pinup Artist Management came along. And once we had a management, the record was kind of like, you know, in our near future to write and stuff. We were like, let's just keep rolling. Let's just keep touring. And now when we have this record, it'll be time to fully like full send it. Let's shop it around. Let's try to make some noise. You know, and I think that's kind of where it became like real, you know, for we've never talked about labels or this. We always wanted to do everything ourselves. And it was working too, you know, so it was definitely like a step that we all needed to take.
Yeah.
You know, 2018 came around and
it was like right after that first full US tour, man, it kind of like started to just get real serious for us. And then got the management, got, you know, Sean Mott was our booking agent at the time. And then, you know, then came Stay Sick and that whole thing.
Yes.
So, but yeah, it got serious right around those, you know, 27, 2018 for us. And it was a sick it was a sick pace we were on at that time. We were touring like 6 to 7 months out of the year and, you know, coming home for just 3 weeks, sometimes 2 weeks, and then back out for another region or something like that. Yeah. We loved it, dude. And that's the pace that we are still like at mentally, like, you know, it's just now since we were quiet for a while, getting back to that pace, it's kind of a pain in the ass.
It's a momentum game, yeah,
for sure.
But it's like, you know,
but we all still want to be right where we were at, you know, like it's not like we're just tired of it, we gotta be a little bit more strict on what we do, or it's none of that. Like, we still have the same drive that we had when we were doing it every other month or whatever it was.
For context here, for my own little tangent, James, where are you in 2017, 18 if this is happening?
Yeah, so that's a good question, honestly.
If this is your first, like, recording, the video we're doing, then, like, are you starting vocals this time? Or are you, like,
so
in high school
I've
talent
shows?
I've actually
been doing
like,
vocals what's since going on? I was about 11, actually.
Damn.
I got given like both singing and screaming. I got given a... Creatures by Motionless and White.
Oh, hell yeah.
By my babysitter's boyfriend. And from that moment on, I just like fell in love.
Was Pinder the babysitter's boyfriend?
Might as well have been at that point in time. But I just like, I fell in love and I just like hustled doing that like literally every day when I got home from school for years on end. Played a couple local shows when I was like 15, 16. And then when I was 17, good buddy of mine, Eddie Knight, he is also a photographer. He does touring nowadays and everything. But he started a band called Dead Culture. They started taking me out on my first tours around then. And I want to say around 2018, 19, I met these guys for the first time. It's actually funny. Both me and Pin came into the band as fans first. But yeah. Around that time, I was just doing my own thing, touring, running merch for Dead Culture, just making connections, doing that for a couple years. Kind of dropped out for about a year and a half or so until 2022. And then I got an offer from a good friend of mine, Billy Blanton, to drive production for As I Lay Dying. And that was around the time that Toast left the band and everything. I was sitting outside of the... Newark, New Jersey airport, actually, when I saw the post, I saw the post for the first time, and I'm like, damn, they need a vocalist. Like, they need like a fill-in for a tour. I was like, I've never even tracked vocals before, but I'm going to send them a shit ton of like cell phone videos I have.
Yeah, we literally got videos in the, of in him the driving rental the truck. Box truck.
Like, yeah. You can hear the truck on the road. Audio.
And the best part of it is that he sent us all of this stuff, like, on demand, too. Like, not rude demand, but on demand. We were like, yo, can we hear something? And this kid would just, like, put Sleep Token on and sing, because we're looking to sing. And, then, like, he said the direction, you know, we had accepted we wanted to get lighter, but James brought in another element that was, like, what he said. We kind of battled on it, but, like, now the newer stuff we're writing is in that direction. But this kid was like, all right, bet, and just sent us singing songs in a box truck. And then we said no. Well, not said no, but we
forgot about me.
We kind of left him on red.
Yeah, because we had a tour coming up, and he didn't have his passport at the time, and there was Canadian dates. So we were like, okay, that's off the table. But then 3 months go by, and we're sitting there like, yo, we don't have the guy yet.
Yep.
And we're like, what about this? What about James? Like, the only reason he didn't do it at the time was the passport. So we're like, let's revisit.
So then he sends us another batch of box truck videos.
And a picture of his passport.
Yep.
And then, yeah, then he did a more professional cover of World of Black.
With Justin from Miss May I. Shout out. Great, yeah. Great dude.
And then we kind of were just like sick. Like, you know, took the time to dive in on his vocals, the range, the ability to do different things. And, you know, now we have the ability to sing, and now that opens up a whole door to just writing and just being creative and dropping whatever we want at this point, because now we have someone that can do both sides of the coin that we want to be on. You know what I mean? If we want to be super heavy for a song, we can be really heavy now. And then if we want to be super light, now we can.
Yep.
So the process was a little painful at first with trying to get a firm of like, yeah, we're going to rock. And, you know, he had the patience to deal with it because, you know, most dudes that are vocalists probably would have been like, nah, you guys are
definitely a multi-month process.
It took
very
a while.
Long
we
process.
Were locked in on someone else, too, unfortunately, for a few months. And, you know, like what we were saying before, like when taking members in is so hard. Yep. And, you know, James was the one that when we did 4 dates with him with Last 10, we had a practice and he did one song at practice and sat on the couch and chilled. And then I had an anxiety attack 4 minutes before we played, and then he crushed it. So the trust was built there.
By force.
Yeah. Was not.
I was like, I'm just going to fucking rock it. I know this
and
shit.
And it wasn't like I didn't feel comfortable to like pause practice and just be like, yo, hello.
Yeah.
He paid for practice, his share. I can't complain. So, whatever. You know, and he crushed it at the end of the day. And obviously, there's more to learn. Better. Everyone has to get better at their craft and better in their field and on stage. But it was like a shoo-in for that. And like now it's the in-house growing pains that just come with everything. And it's a process, though, but it's a process that we're happy to have because it's a healthy one.
Yeah.
We have someone that wants to do some stuff and has ideas. Sometimes it's like, hey, not yet. But it's I would take that over anything just because it's there and the drive is there and the want is there.
Yep.
So I'm glad that, you know, it took a few months. I'm glad there was some BS and some whatnot.
Yeah. I think in a band, it's always you get paralyzed by like waiting for someone else to do or letting someone else take the lead on the thing. And yeah, you're right. You need someone to come in and be like, here's a song. Like, yeah. I don't know if you like it. I don't know if you don't like it, but at least here it is. And we can find something we dislike. Yeah. We can have a conversation about it. But like, yeah, you need someone to come in and like do something where I feel like the common issue I see in bands, like this paralysis of like everyone's kind of waiting for someone else to do something or waiting to make this thing perfect before they send it to the boys. And it's like no one grows in that sense. Like it has to be an effort of everyone putting something forward and being vulnerable in that effort of like, I don't know if this is a good idea. You might all hate this idea, but here is an idea. Let's start from there and build. And it sounds like that was, a big motivator, something that helped kind of get you guys back in motion again.
Yeah, I think it was cool, too, because like, you know, he mentions in 2016, 2017, and then even 2018, 2019, like touring with Dead Culture and doing touring work. And, you know, like that was a huge thing that we looked at. You know, like when I started touring, I was 17. So, you know, at a young age, having some experience, even at a lower level, was huge for me, even if he had never been in a band. Mm-hmm. So seeing like the work ethic and him finding his way to be on the road and create a job for himself at a young age, I don't know, that spoke to us. You know, even Dead Culture as a band, when they were touring, you know, that how many days of the year was it the 1 year?
2019, we were on the road 230-ish days out of the year.
The fuck?
Just touring DIY. Yeah. I was running merch. I wasn't making shit for money. I was just like, I want to be out here on the road, and I want to experience this shit and, like, learn how to do this. So that's fucking
and that's honestly how you're supposed to do it.
Yeah.
I just remember, like, every other week, it'd be like, Dead Culture run, week and a half, another region, and you're like,
but
wow,
I remember looking
aren't
at these
they
guys
on tour right
yeah.
now?
I remember looking at them and going, like, this is 2019, guys. We did this in 2016. Like, this is sick. Like, this is a band doing exactly what we did.
Yep.
And I just wanted to support them in any way possible. You know, anytime we went to Cincinnati, Dead Culture was on the show. So we were able to meet James multiple times before. And we developed like that friendship level before even thinking about him as a vocalist.
Yep.
So there are definitely like little textures throughout those years that James was kind of like always in the corner in a way. You know, we'd play shows and he'd rock the guest spot. So... Face in the corner.
Face in the corner.
Yeah, James is a face in the corner.
He'll have that. I think that's like the benefit of me coming into the band as a fan too, is being able to like dissect what I loved and what I thought could have been better, and then coming into the band and being able to apply those same things. Like I think it's like I'm comfortably saying that this is the best material that we are ever putting out, the best content visually that we are ever working on. Like it's all just been amplified, and I cannot thank all three of these guys enough for like being willing to work with me on that aspect. Honestly, because I'm sure it was very scary to be able to have somebody come in and be like, I want to do this, 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 and this, but we'll see how it works.
We like that, exactly like that though. But like James didn't come into the seat and go like, we're doing this, this, this. It was, he did take the time to kind of like take a seat, learn. And, like, did get to learn how the band worked, the ebb and flow. And it's still will always, you know, like I said, we've been together for, like, 8 years, unified. Like, I've lived with him. I've lived with him. I currently live with him. We're going to move out together. Like, we've been unified. We spent years worth of time in a van together. So, like, obviously, there's going to be a gap. But James is filling in that little gap. And he is picking up the pieces that we did need. And that's the important part.
Yep.
But, it's like... You know, sometimes, man, like being in a band and getting a new guy is like the scariest thing, like because you are, and of all places, it's the vocalist. It's like, yo, like this is the guy that represents your band more than anyone else. Because at the end of the day, most people go to merch and see Pinder and be like, yo, like what size shirt can I get? And like, yo, tell the band they were sick. You know how many times I've literally held a phone to take pictures of like Toast and Saxz. Like people don't really care. And, you know, so, like, the vocalist is the guy. Especially when you're a younger band, they have to be the one to connect. And it's a lot of trust to put into someone.
Yep.
But, like, he came in, wants to write lyrics, wants to contribute, wants to write melodies, wants to do all this stuff. So it's, like, sick.
Let's
like,
do it.
Sick. Yeah. That's the energy and the effort that we need as a band.
Hell yeah.
As every band needs from everybody. You know what I mean?
Hell yeah. So things are on the up and up now. I think where our chronology left off here was getting, 2019, which means that 2020 is looming, which is everyone's favorite year. I assume that, 2019 is we're building momentum. We just finished up a national tour. We've done some more regional touring and, more touring in general. I assume then 2020 crashes to a halt like it does for everyone else and kind of starts a little bit of a slide for everyone. Like, is that a... I guess you were in Europe a little bit after that. So I guess maybe momentum continued.
I mean, 2020 started off well because it was like the spring when it shut down. So like we started that year off with the Body Snatcher album release show, album release tour for This Heavy Void. So we really had, that was like our biggest tour we've ever done to date. And like at that rate, like we really felt the momentum going and then it all came to a halt after
that. We had gotten home and had confirmed like what probably would have been like our biggest set of tours. Mm-hmm. And then
can I ask what those would have been, or is it
kosher to talk about? I think it was a Gideon headliner.
That's sick.
Body Snatcher was on it again because they got the same message that we got. Like we were on the tour and we were like, "Yo, we got this," and they're like, "Oh, we did too." We're like, "No way!" And there was a couple other bands that they were talking about getting on there as well.
That's sick.
But it would have just been a 4-band package. And at first, we got the offer for like the first 2 weeks. And then as weeks went by, it turned into like a full offer of like, hey, do they actually just want to do the whole thing? So it would have been a full U.S. It would have been the summertime to pretty much follow up that Body Snatcher Spring tour. It definitely would have been going.
And this was through management. So this isn't your booking. This is someone else.
I literally got the offer, like, kind of on a, like how you would want it to happen. It kind of did for us, and then it didn't happen. And
the momentum was really built though, because like even taking it back a little bit.
Sure.
Before we decided to put out like the record and shop it out, we wanted to like have things lined up that made our worth a little bit more to when we were shopping, you know. Oh, they have this and this and this. And at the time, I think we made the full switch of DIY booking to Sean Mott in 2018.
Okay.
So by 2019, you know, we had like a plan. You know, we had a couple tours through him under someone else booking. And we brought the idea to him. We were like, yo, we need to hit this like hard before we start shopping. Hmm. And he was able to land us two shows on Warped Tour. Two dates for Warped Tour, and a bunch of other fests, even some that we didn't fit on, like East Coast Tsunami, a hardcore fest in PA.
Hell yeah.
Us and Body Snatcher were like the only non-hardcore bands on it, but it was sick. But he was doing everything he could to keep us active and to keep us doing things of worth as well. And from that point on, you know, we were able to get signed, and with the record, we were able to sell a decent amount first week, and you know, we billboarded with the record, and things were really going into that 2020 year. So to have all that kind of go into the Body Snatcher tour, get that tour offer while we're on the Body Snatcher tour, we just felt like everything was finally like starting to like pay off, you know. And then of course we got home, we played, remember that Spite tour, their headliner, it had Dealer on it.
Sure.
It was in March, okay. And it was a Burials. I Am. It was a stacked tour.
Orthodox too.
But
I think
we played the Jersey date, and that was like few days after we had gotten home from the Body Snatcher tour, and like 2 days after that, it shut down.
2020 was my first year being fully self-employed, so it's a similar story of like January 1 comes around and it's like fuck it, all the ties are cut, like I'm finally doing this thing, and then it's 3 months of like oh this is gonna work, and yeah, just to your point, it's like oh no, very quickly unraveled. Stuck in that point. The other part of this that I would be remiss if I didn't ask about is the label. So we can talk about them by name, we can talk about it more generally, but there is a label signing in this process. I assume that also goes in this, like, that is the biggest wind in our sails. I assume to this point in our lives, everything looks like we need a record label. That is the key to success. And in 2019, 2020, I think more so than now, it still felt like a label was, like, the only way to a degree.
not gonna lie, it was great.
Yeah.
It helped us tremendously. And you know, not gonna go like too far into detail, I'll be real, like, you know, there was a lot of bands that talked a lot of bad things, rightfully so.
Sure.
We didn't
just never saw that.
We never got that side.
We never saw it.
And you know, there was an end of it that was a little hectic regarding, and that, you know, it played into the reason why the record had not come out sooner. But we all, you know, things were met in the middle, and you know, everyone ended up kind of being happy with the solution of
it. Every band needs a story, right? They need that first label story. That's all it was. It was nothing that broke us.
Yeah.
Nothing that I could have been like, I didn't see this coming. Mm-hmm. You know, it could have been better.
Sure.
But I think you could say that about pretty much anything when you're pursuing this kind of career. Like, the band, everyone says, is more negatives, you know, than positives. More failures than reward, you know?
Yep.
So
that's most journeys. And I think if a band is a business, especially if we can simplify a band to that context of being a business, then like
it pretty much is. Yeah.
I'd like to believe it's more. I'd like to believe that it's art.
There's way more behind the scenes. The music is like half.
I wouldn't even look at it as a loss though, you know? Like if you're looking at it as like an entrepreneur kind of guy and you're like, hey, you know, was this a failure? Like for them, yes.
Sure.
But for us, like, no, not really. Like, you know, there's some things that I wish we kind of got better on, but I'm happy with it, you know, like I'm happy we're off. Mm-hmm. I'm happy we're able to explore our new options and all that, but
It did what we needed for the
time. I'm grateful for the lesson, you know, and I'm grateful for the things that we were given, and I'm grateful for the things that we kind of had to learn the hard way.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's no bad blood and there's no like anger. It's not like we're going to write a record about them. You know,
if you do, make it about issues and start a new band.
Yeah, right.
Seems like it worked out pretty well for them.
But it was cool. You know, it's not like we've turned into this band that's like anti-establishment. Like, you know, you don't need a label, and it, you know, there's that whole other, that's a whole other you know, podcast argument. Discussion. Yeah. But like, yeah, man, it was cool. I was stoked about it. You know, I got nothing bad to say.
Yeah.
You know,
like you said, at the time when it did seem like it was more of a key factor for bands to kind of have that in their corner, we definitely felt like we finally like pushed through and we were going to start like really making bigger moves and be able to kind of like take it to the next level. But yeah, once 2020 hit, everything kind of shut down. And I think everyone was kind of scared because no one knew when things were going to come back.
Yeah.
You know, all the bands were scrambling to like, what can we do? What podcast can get on? How can we stay relevant? So I think, I mean, that year was just tough for everyone.
Oh yeah.
But that kind of like led us into just coming up with, we got to release something. We have to keep the fans like happy, which brought like the Dervy to EP, the three songs, which, arguably is, you know, our most successful release, at this time, I'd say.
Yeah. By far. I mean,
numbers wise. Yeah.
COVID was like a blessing like that. Like, you know, and I'm not going to lie. Like
everyone was home to consume media.
As a band, saw each other so much during COVID. We spent days, weeks together. We
did barbecues every weekend on the back deck.
We had a system and it was kind of worked out where like, you know, most of us didn't have a job. I like had a job, but like was in and out of it. I work in the restaurant industry. So like,
give or take. What were you doing during COVID?
Jack shit, brother. I was collecting unemployment. I was just living my goddamn best life. You got me fucked up. Warzone just came out. I was sitting there drinking a case of claws a day. I was like, yeah, baby. Like,
yeah.
Hell yeah, dude.
Yeah, it was a weird...
Honestly,
it was weird.
COVID was kind of lit.
It was like surreal.
Like, depending on what side you're on, like,
it didn't
COVID
feel
was...
real for like the first like half a year. You're like, all right, this is going to stop. And then it kept going.
It was a mental thing, I think.
It definitely took a mental strain.
And depending on what type of person you are, like if you're a homebody kind of guy, you know, maybe missing work was the weird thing, but like you kind of were all right. But like being a social person, if you go out a lot, you meet, see people, see friends, go to shows, go on tour, et cetera, like that. It shifted a lot of things. And that was like the most time I'd ever spent like alone.
Yeah.
And then, you know, if I wasn't at work or sitting in a room isolated, I was with them doing our things and doing whatever. But like, yeah, Dirt Vita came out of it. And that's like what I'm like the most proud thing that we've put out so far.
Hell yeah.
You know, that was written in a coffee shop. So like the only place I could go during COVID that stayed open was a Republican ran coffee shop, baby. They said, don't get the jab, get our espresso. So, I can't lie. I got the jab, but I also did get the espresso. So, like, I got the best of both worlds.
One for here and one to go.
That's crazy.
I want to touch on the label thing for one more second. So, in a perfect world, there's a number for everything, right? So, I guess my simple question here is, like, would you sign another label contract in the future?
100%.
And, like, I say that, like, there's a number, right? Someone says, here's a bajillion dollar for advance, like, yeah, you're gonna fucking take it. It's but like, does it still seem like it's on the to-do list, or is it like a
depends.
It works
out
great, but
there's just more to look at now.
Yeah,
like, so it all comes down to percentages at the end of the day.
Okay.
Like whether they touch like tour merch and stuff like that.
Yeah,
but
like
we're not opposed to it.
The
at
details
all.
of it are a little bit more in depth than they were. Like we were kind of just looking for that entry level.
Yeah.
Where now we're looking at like, okay, who are we working with? You know, maybe what kind of person is he?
What
bands does he have?
What's the plan, man? What's the plan?
Yeah. Like, and who have you executed a plan for in the past? Because I think it seems like...
We work well when people tell us what to do.
Okay.
You know, if someone is...
Give us the fucking game plan and we'll knock it out. That's all
we
need.
Yeah, like, we will get it done, you know? And if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. But we tried.
Yeah.
It didn't leave a sour taste, so, you know? It's like, you know, you date a girl, she cheated on you. Is the next girl going to cheat on you? It's like not every girl's the same. Not every label's the same. Not every situation's the same.
Sure.
So like, yeah, it sucked. It was a weird situation. But it's not like we're going to sign the next record label and sign the next deal and just be like, hey, we have anxiety, man. What's going on? It's not like that, you know?
And also, it's not about like expect. It's like expectations.
Yeah.
Like, it's totally different than what it was for us now.
Yep.
We're not like looking for it to change our life, you know, just help us on the path that we're already on.
Yeah.
More so.
Empower us more. So.
Just
yeah.
building, yeah. man. We just want to build the brand, build the band. We want to do a lot of different things. And, you know, it would be sick to have people on board that were that are trying to do the same thing and see the value and see the vision that we have. And yep. and you know, luckily right now the team that we have gets it. Mm-hmm. And now it's about building and just keep it going.
Yeah, I was gonna say, even if there is no label in the picture, the team is just important, you know, and I think we had to take a step back and really rebuild. And I think that was actually the hardest part of all of this. Was like, now that we are kind of free, or do we want to jump back into putting ourselves out there for other people, or do mm-hmm. we kind of want to just ride it on our own again?
Yeah.
And that's kind of like the mindset we had with like dropping the first song independently. And you know, even this next song that we just filmed a video for will also be dropped independently. Like I said earlier, like we're kind of just doing this for ourselves now, you know, because that's kind of where we started.
What, when you say team, I think it's booking and management.
Booking, management, okay. agent, lawyers, close friend. Like it could be anyone, you know, yeah. anyone that you consider, like you were saying, like those unspoken members of the band. You know, every band has that team.
Yep.
And it's not easy when life comes at you and you see some of your team members falling, and it's not yep. just a replacement. It's so much more than that. Yep. So, you know, like even down to touring. You know, we used to have a couple people that would come out all the time, and due to busy schedules and just how things have gone, probably would not be the same team, you know? So things are always cycling. Things are always going to change. But when it's more about, like, the business, you have to, like, you'd be doing yourself a disservice by not, like, taking extra careful, like,
yeah.
you know, looking at it under a microscope and being like, what do we really want to do? Do we want to jump into this? Or not.
I got some business advice that was like, if you want to go far, go together, which is one of those like cheesy things. And it's like, I'm sure there's pros and cons to it. But for me, it's like I'm self-employed, right? I go everywhere alone in theory. And in theory, I'm going with a band, kind of, but I'm going with you guys for a month. And then for the other 11 months, it's my problem to figure out what the hell's happening, right? Yeah. You guys are not responsible for those other 11 months. And so it kind of spawned this like weird part of me that's like, should I look into a business partner? Should I look into like bring someone else in? And I think ultimately I love having so much control. I love being able to dictate myself. And I think that I can push myself so hard that anyone else I bring on is, I'm doing them a disservice because I'm going to expect so much of them that is not possible for another human because I ask it of myself, but I can't ask it of them. I can ask me to work 16 hours a day. It's fine. Like I'll figure it out. But like, I can't ask someone else to give up their whole life for my dream, for my idea here.
It's kind of like a similar concept to like when we're getting merch designs done. Yep. As a graphic designer, you know, I have a vision for certain things or certain things that I see that I'm like, this needs to get changed. Yep. And more times than not, we'll get a design back. And I'll have so many edits to where it's like almost just like I did it myself anyway. Yep. So, you know, and obviously not a knock at any designer we've ever worked with because, you know, we've gotten plenty of designs that we love. But just as a creative, like you were saying, to have all of that, like, expectation on yourself is one thing, but then to project it to someone else is not fair in a way.
I think the other piece here that I have to be very honest with myself about is, like, it's also an ego thing. Like, I don't want someone else under my roof because I don't want to have to share the reward with someone. Like, to some degree, part of what I love about this is, like, this is mine. And whether it's huge or tiny, it's mine, and I can own every part of it and every piece of it I'm the expert on. And, like, there's an ownership and a pride I take from doing it. And so I think for you guys, it's, like, when your DNA is doing everything DIY, I think it's a really, like, brave and bold thing to be like, no, we do need a team. Like, Saxz is a great booker, but like there's probably someone else who can do this a little more efficiently and do this better for us.
I don't want to put him through that. That's just rough to deal with.
Yeah, for sure.
But yeah, I think there's a bravery and a nobility there in expanding the team and making that all happen. So 2020, the team changed a little bit. We shift a little bit. At some point, this ends up back in Europe in 2022, I think was the other big talking point or big timeline point here I saw here. I'm realizing now I should have looked up the flyer. I have no idea what you're doing in Europe, what was going on in Europe. I know we were in Europe in 22. What was going on there?
In May 2022?
Yeah, we were with King 810.
That's huge. Hell yeah.
His side project, Yavid, his rap project.
Okay.
And then Cabal.
I haven't heard of Yavid, but it sounds like my new favorite band. Like, it sounds like it the is, mutt that it's right up my alley.
There's nothing else like it.
If all I have to say is just, like, picture, like, Dave Gunn just rapping. And then you get it.
I'm invested.
It's but hella different styles and like stories on stories. Yeah, lyrical.
Tell me there's a King Von feature and I'm there.
Crazy shit.
It's just like touring with the guy, like you kind of learn that like everything that they talk about is real.
Yeah.
But they're like really nice guys and nice to tour with. But like, absolutely would never get on their bad side, for lack of a better way to put it.
Sure.
But yeah, Europe was May, our first time there. And that was just kind of like a thing, like, you know, being through Avocado, we got the tour offer. And like, regardless of if we felt like we fit, it was like, all right, like a ticket to Europe, like we got to take it. Yeah. And it was
like a full month, like a full.
It was just like 3 weeks, about, I think.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Well, we didn't even know if the tour was going to happen because I was right when the entire Ukraine-Russia thing started.
Sure.
There was a Ukraine date on the tour originally that did get canceled because of the war.
Damn.
So the closest that we got to the physical war was Warsaw in Poland.
Yep. Yeah. There were people who were fleeing.
And there was refugees at the show.
Yeah.
It was just like surreal. Yeah.
Very rough.
We had a crazy, like a lot. It was, you know, being there. So we were spending a lot of time out in the show and, you know, outside, you know, token around with people, you know, talk to a few people that were there. And, you know, some woman was at the show that apartment got bombed, had to flee. Her husband got killed. And now she's living in a random dude's apartment in Warsaw. And she left her two kids with this man to go to a King 810 show because she loves that band so much.
What a...
Right.
It puts into perspective, man. You know, like I got a lot of people that said they don't like America. And it comes from that perspective of like, yeah, like, you know, like Americans think that they have it real bad, man. And like there are people who have it bad, don't get me wrong, but like overall stigma, some people think it's woe is me. Like, but like, dude, your apartment got bombed by another country and you fled with your two children, widowed.
What a I think
crazy
to be in Europe because of metalcore or metal.
It was
music
the biggest
has
it was
to be like a
the coolest was, thing in the world.
And then to contrast that with this woman who is as low in the fortune scale as
is at the same place I'm at.
Be.
For the same reason.
Yeah.
For the same reason. Because for music, at the end of the day, that's why she was there and why I was there. And that's a crazy thing to realize. Like playing your first set, which, dude, blew our backtracks during soundtrack.
Is this a power issue as well?
Anything about that. So like day one, I go to put my rack on and it is, and I see smoke coming out. And I'm acting like I did nothing wrong. I turn it off real quick, act like I didn't do anything. And I'm like, yo, guys, it's not working. And everyone's like, what? And it just goes from, yo, you're on in 30. Yo, you're on in 20. Yo, you got 10 minutes. And I haven't made any moves yet. Like, I'm still just, like, struggling to, like, what do I do?
Yep.
And we had people trying to help us, but the whole thing was fried. Marco from Avocado, the agent at the time, was at the show. First European show. We had to play it, no backtracks. Merch got delayed, didn't have merch. It was a nightmare for sure, but you know, we got through it.
Yeah,
for sure.
Given all that, like playing a show like in Munich, Germany for the first time like in your life, like,
and it was on the day we landed. So we landed at the airport at like 6 a.m. their time, got on the bus, fell asleep for a few hours, ended up at the venue, had to load in and play.
Yeah, the whole tour package was on the tour bus, and we like woke up and had no idea because we were just shot.
Jet lagged.
I was like,
I'm not gonna fall asleep. I'll be good.
We left at like 5 p.m. like 7 o'clock our time, and like landed at 7 a.m. Like we skipped a whole night.
Yep.
And like
that was rough.
Flying to Europe, dude. Let me tell you, no.
Not that cool. Yep. Yeah,
it's pretty fucking rough.
I was sitting next to Toast, and like both me and him, like not a fan at the time. Like, dude, flying was not cool. And like this flight line, had the ability to turn on a live camera from the bottom of the plane. Like, you can literally look at a live view of where you're at. And our movies froze. And he like tapped the screen to go back, and it went to the live camera, dude. And he froze and tapped me, and I was watching House of Gucci. Great time, dude. I was honestly living. And then I looked over at his screen, and I was like, dude. And then he hit the map, and we were just over the Atlantic Ocean. Like,
yep.
Dude, like, you know, what do I do?
Yeah.
Nothing, dude.
Nothing, dude. That's the answer. I do nothing but turn on House of Gucci and just continue to watch Adam Driver and Lady Gaga. And hope that I land.
Stay invested. Yep.
Not sick, dude.
No. Now, my mom's from South America. So we would go to Chile every like 3 or 4 years for like 2 or 3 weeks in the winter. And I don't think, like, now that I fly, it doesn't dawn on me like how weird that was as a kid to be like, as a kid flying 12 hours to Chile, it was like, yeah, this is just what we do every couple winters.
Yeah.
And now it's like, yo, I could never be in that fucking tube for 12 hours. Like, it seems impossible.
So you fly a lot?
I did. I haven't as much recently. Now it's been like a more normal, like, Texas or something.
I hate it so much.
I don't mind it.
Honestly. Dude, I just kind of accept it because, like, if you're going to die, bro, the plane's crashing within 20 seconds of taking off or landing. And if you can make it that 20 seconds, you're fine.
You ever get in a car, man? And, like, I'm not going to get too sidetracked here, but do you ever get into a car?
Here we go.
I go on this tangent all the time, but you ever get into a car, dude, and you just, like, see a car with, and, like, you think of the person sitting, and they're just sitting like this.
Yep.
Driving around 60 miles an hour. Like, that's funny to me.
Now take the car. Now take the car away.
Now put up. Yeah, like, they're just sitting there. Okay,
now do that.
In a plane, going 700 miles an hour, 33,000 feet in the air. And everyone's just on the flight, bro, just like worrying about the portions of peanuts that they get. Meanwhile, you are doing something birds can't do.
Yep.
And no one questions it. And have you ever looked up who invented flying? Look up a picture
sounds like of the, you have.
Because it makes no sense to me, man.
You mean the Wright brothers?
The Wright brother. Look up a picture of the Wright brothers and now get into a Boeing.
That was Wright get brothers. Was your answer. I thought you had some cool, like, new
science. I did my research.
The Wright brothers. Are you smarter than a fifth grader? No, but the Wright brothers. But, like, yeah, look at a picture of them and then walk into a Boeing and tell me you feel safe.
I'll tell you what. I'll one-up this story and then get us back on the track here. But my grandpa was in World War II. And so when he passed, we had his journal, and I, like, transcribed the journal and gave it to our family as, like, the pictures of the journal of his, like, yeah, he was in the Air Force. He was over there talking about bombing runs and all the bullshit. My grandpa had never left home. He'd never left his town. He'd never seen a plane, never, like, done anything with aviation. And then 6 months later, he's flying bombing Europe. And it's like, that's crazy. A crazy jump for, like, yeah, to your point of the guy just sitting there. It's like, imagine, yeah, he'd never knew what the fuck this thing was. And now he's doing it, yeah.
He's 30,000 feet in the air going, I'm floating, and then I'm bombing.
Yep. Yeah.
I'm not going to lie, man. Some might say that is absolutely the USA way right there.
It's something for sure. It was the USA way at the time.
But that's crazy, dude. I could go on this tangent for hours because flying just doesn't make any sense.
Well, I would love to hear more about flying, but we are just about past our hour, so no rush at all. But yeah, we're doing great on time here. The last little piece here, so yeah, Europe happens. Then we got kind of 2 years to get us to now, and it sounds like there's been a lot of behind-the-scenes work happening, but we don't have a lot to show for it right this second. So there's probably a lot cooking, a lot in the pot, but not a lot on the internet, not a lot that I can go find quite this second. So yeah, what have been the last 2 years? What's been the theme?
Yeah, since we get back to Europe? Like, quick backstory from 2020, like, that EP, Derivita, definitely kind of kept us afloat. And that's kind of how we were able to land the European tour.
I like the little callback there.
So, like, we were able to actually, you know, have something in the future that we were like, okay, this is a good way for us to come back out of COVID. And for a while, we didn't even know if the tour was going to happen or how it was going to do because we didn't know if people would be scared to go to shows. So that was just an interesting experience in itself, just like the lead up to, is this going to happen and how is it going to go? But after doing Europe and coming home, you know, we were so happy that we had done it successfully. You know, we hear horror stories of bands doing their first overseas tour, whether it's Japan, Australia, and just coming back in huge in the red, you know? So we had the expectation of, like, yeah, this could be us as well, you know? And this is just a risk we're willing to take, something that we wanted to all experience as a group as well. So we took it, you know? And we were super happy when we came back and we could say that we had done it successfully. It didn't break the band. And shortly after that, you know, we had some internal issues. They kind of blew up, for lack of a better word.
Sure.
But we ended up just having to mutually split ways with our vocalist. You know, he decided to take on a different path, fully, you know, backed him on that and whatnot. But we also agreed that, like, even if he did want to stay, it just wouldn't work with, you know, where we were trying to go and kind of how the last, like, couple months had gone. So, yeah, we were put in this really difficult position because now we're coming off of this European tour. COVID is here. Like, we know we need new music to come out. And, you know, the record had been done. We had, like, the new record with Cody Stewart done for so long. And we were just waiting for the right moves to put these songs out. So once that European tour got booked, we had two singles that came out before that. Those two singles were actually from the record that we were kind of, like, leading everything up to. So once Ryan left, we kind of had to renavigate our entire game plan. Like, yeah. What are we going to do? Because now two songs are out with him on a record. He's not our vocalist. Like, So it took a very long time for us to even sit with the fact that, like, okay, this is the position we're in. Yep. And it was kind of hard for us to, like, take it in because we had worked so hard to get to where we were. And knowing what was kind of taken away from COVID, coming back, and then having something else, like, stripped away.
Yeah.
It was just, like, two punches, you know, real quick.
Yeah. At your most vulnerable time. Yeah.
Exactly. You know, like, we were like, what do we do? And for those months, I know, like, for me personally, it was the hardest time of my entire life. The band is, without a doubt, like, one of the biggest parts of my life. Music in general just keeps me going. So, like, I had thoughts of, like, is the band going to be done? Do we have to start over? Is it a better move to just start over? Mm-hmm. Like, oh, how are our fans going to take it if, you know, this vocalist who's been with us for 6 years, we've been building this image, is just now gone and we introduce someone else? He had a very specific style, too, to him, you know? He had that rap metal style and very hard to replicate. I think we did a really good job from 2020, like I was saying, when we started to really build that identity. I think we did a really good job over those years of really building who we were as a band. So like you said, like at our most vulnerable time, when everything is going great, things kind of hit the fan.
Things change, yeah.
Yeah.
It was a shot time. Yeah. A lot behind the scenes, a lot of personal stuff. You know, and it kind of got hectic, man, and it brought the band down because we kind of had to deal with that. And then we went out on a tour while dealing with it, with a fill-in
vocalist. That was another thing. We had a tour booked.
I thought a rocket scientist, that sounds like a bad idea.
Yeah, we had the tour booked,
but we had to do it.
For the U.S. for like 3 months after we got back, okay. After Europe. And it was kind of already locked in. And this was the first piece of the puzzle of the team that we were rebuilding. It was a new agent. So we were like, we just want to do this tour.
Okay, and
we
don't want to let them down. In the
exactly.
First
like thing. We want to yeah. just like, yeah. let's start off on a good note here. So we had to find the fill-in, and that was the fill-in we mentioned that James couldn't do with the passport.
Yep.
But yeah, we kind of did that tour in like this clouded mindset of like no stress. Like we don't even know what we're doing out here. We're just kind of playing shows. If there's kids, cool. If not, whatever. We got bigger shit we got to figure out when we get home. Like yeah. It was like literally just kind of get through.
Was that freeing? It's almost like it sounds like when I'm making a music video, when I try and make a good video, I think it comes out the way it comes out. And I think the best videos are when I show up and go, something's going to happen today. Let's just point a camera and figure it out. And there's something free in that where it's like, yeah, the stress comes off. And I'm wondering if for you guys in that time, like the performance on stage were almost more fun and easier because there wasn't all this other bullshit. It was like you could just be pure and like you were 16 again.
No.
No? Okay.
Dude, it was, that was my worst tour. That wasn't the most, not fun. And it had nothing to do with the dudes on tour or the bands. Yeah. They were, like, some of my closest friends. Just mindset, mental stuff. But, like, it was just the weirdest thing for me to go from a European tour, having some good shit looking up, to now a random. You know what I mean?
It was a completely different band. It was a completely different environment. But I will say that I think that tour was extremely important for us. Because we had no expectations. It was our first time, quote unquote, headlining any shows on the other side of the country. You know, first time doing West Coast as a headliner, co-headliner kind of vibe. And the shows crushed. And, like, I think at our lowest point, to see what we were able to kind of, like, pull out through that time, we got back from that tour and we were like, yo, we have shit to figure out because this can't stop.
Yeah,
kind of thing.
Yeah.
So it was momentum, as much as it was frustrating.
Kind of lit the fire again.
Yeah, the savior
was having the record done. I think that was the big savior because any work done after that was easy work compared to writing a whole new record. So we, you know, like having James come in confirmed all that stuff. Like, you know, took Rat in the Room and Face in the Corner off the record, and rewrote some, and then like I said, added some new songs too. So. It worked out. It was just a very dark, for real, like dark time, and being in a band for your whole life and having it be, like Saxz said, pretty much like your whole life.
Yeah.
When it's in like the hands of you don't know what's gonna happen, it kind of fucks you up a little bit, man.
I'm sure.
Yeah, like over the course of the last 2 years, essentially, from 2022, we had to retrack the entire record because it was already done with Ryan's vocals. Mm-hmm. Like Chip had mentioned, Face in the Corner, Rat in the Room, those singles were on the record, came out. We decided to just make those Toast's last pieces with us and take them off the record. And, you know, throughout that time, we were like, we now have a vocalist. We locked him in.
Stopped playing Warzone at the time.
Yeah, right, right, for sure. I was like, man, I get to like do something with myself for once. Fuck then, it, let's rock.
You know, we did the last 10 little 4-day run that we had mentioned as well, where it was James's first shows with us, and it did great. And I think that was like, it locked us into like, okay, guys, next year we're figuring this out. We have to line up again. It's been a long time. The record's done. We know what we need to do. Immediately called up Cody Stewart, told him the whole plan, and really went straight to the studio essentially as soon as the year started.
Oh, yeah.
And banged out the entire record. James did all of the songs vocally in what, 2 days, 3 days?
Something like that. I went on a European tour with Shadow of Intent, running merch for them, and then doing photo for the entire package as well.
He has his own Europe experiences.
The day I got back from Europe, I landed at my home airport, CVG in Cincinnati. These motherfuckers drove 4 hours from Nashville at Cody Stewart's house, picked me up from the airport. I didn't even get to go home. Went straight to the studio, 4-hour drive, and I tracked the first song that night. And I think we got everything done within a week and a half span. It was being mixed, and that's the final product.
To be fair, though, I guess watching Ben Dorr perform in Europe every night would make you come home pretty motivated and ready to track.
I love Ben so much.
Yeah, not a better
Me and him
to
have
watch.
Had
yeah.
so many discussions about Arma 3, and like, dude, like, that man can demolish a Pizza Hut pizza fucking faster than anybody I've ever seen. Shout out Ben, Chris, fucking Andrea, and Bryce from Shadow. I love all of you guys.
Of all the things he can do, the pizza is certainly not the most impressive one.
Oh, dude. It's on the list. You'd be imagining.
I can do that.
You'd be imagining.
I think that depends on who you ask.
Well, I only consider my own opinion there. Yeah. So I asked me. Hell yeah. So that kind of gets us to where we are now. So now we got a record cooking. We got a single out. We did a video yesterday. What can people look forward to in the future? What's coming up? What's on the horizon? Or is there anything on the horizon we can talk about now? Or is it just, Soul City and a single coming at some point whenever this video is ready?
Yeah, I mean, Soul City's out now everywhere. Like I said, Alex is in the video. So if you haven't seen it, definitely go check it out. Yesterday we just filmed a new music video with Black Wolf Imaging, very respected in the industry. Shout out Alex.
Yep.
And let me tell you, that was a wonderful process, wasn't it?
That was fantastic.
I think it was the least,
stressful.
Hell yeah.
Least demanding.
Hell yeah.
But I think it's going to be probably our cleanest video yet. And I'm
really
excited.
Definitely our most cinematic approach to a music video for sure.
But I will say, with the record had been done 2 years ago, we are on this we need to get it out. We don't want to just keep people waiting. You know, we realized Soul City came out in November. Maybe people wanted another single before the end of the year. Just with schedules, it just couldn't happen. So, you know, we are doing everything in our power right now to get these songs delivered to the public in a way that we want to portray it to the people.
Mm-hmm.
And it started with Soul, and it's going to continue with this next video. I will say, you know, we have more than one song coming within the next few months.
Hell yeah.
So it will not just be a one and done kind of drop. We also do have some shows in the works. We have probably thinking about doing a little tour in May, June, July time with a good friends of ours. So we'll see. We'll see. We have some stuff in the works, waiting to hear back from some things. But to be honest, our main focus is really getting this music out. You know, we need to get it out, and we believed in it since the very beginning. It's the reason why we stuck with it. And I think it's going to be a huge weight off our shoulders when we can finally release this and move on. Because to be honest, we haven't really had the full opportunity yet to marinate with James as a vocalist.
Start scratch
and, like
record,
you were saying, you have someone who's comes in and gets the job done, and then the ideas come after kind of thing. So, this is, once the record's done, the whole process and timeline of, James doing his part is kind of, the end.
Yep.
You know, once that's done, it's like a whole different, what we've been wanting to do. So I think, yeah, with this next like couple months, just really focusing on putting out the new songs for you guys.
Hell yeah. That sounds dope. I think it feels like a good place to tie us up here. My one last question here that I would be a bad person if I didn't ask, and it sounds like there's either not a date for the record or not a date that we want to publicly share. But I do have to ask, is there any time that we can expect the record? Is it something we're going to see in the early part of this year, maybe towards the end of the year? Is there anything we can say there, or it'll come when it's ready and we'll see you then?
I will say the batch of the songs on the record, it's 11 tracks, Seoul City being one, so one of them out. They will all be released by the end of the year.
Hell yeah.
Whether it's two EPs, a full length, seven single, whatever it be, mm-hmm. we're kind of just rolling with the flow. And we really just want to make sure that every song gets out there and has the attention that it deserves, because yeah. we don't believe in just one song on this record. Like, yep. this record is 11 songs of born new material that we've never put out before.
Hell yeah.
So
that is the most personal material that we've ever written as a band, like collectively.
Hell yeah.
So
I think we all have a few songs like lyrically that are based around stories from each person's life.
Hell yeah.
So it's going to be a very full circle record, but definitely before the end of the year, for sure. We're not going to keep anyone waiting any longer.
Fuck yeah. Hell yeah, boys. That feels like a good place to put a pin in this. Hell yeah. Before I let you guys get out of here, where can people find you on social media? So I guess we'll go around the little circle here, Pin. I'll start with you. I assume, yeah, follow the band accounts, follow Born Anew, wherever it is. But on personal accounts, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, follow Born Anew on Born Anew NJ on literally every social media thing possible. That's that. I'm Pin, your boy Pin on Instagram, Twitter, all that kind of stuff, TikTok, whatever it is. And then you.
Tyler Potato Chip on everything.
Yes, I'm just going to bleep that out. Oh my God. He's like, yo, dude, what was that?
It's Tyler Potato Chip.
Saxz, what you got? Where are people
Mine is just Tyler Saxz, S-A-X-Z on everything.
James,
where and then are people? I'm Young Yames on everything, Y-U-N-G-Y-X-M-E-S. You can follow me for everything Born Anew related and photography / touring related.
Hell yes.
There's a lot of shit that goes on there. So
yeah, lots of individual stories at some point. I'd love to have you guys back here individually at some point to dive deep into all little stories we glossed over here. But yeah, I appreciate you guys making the trip up here. Appreciate you making it happen, dude.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you, man.
Episode 56, Born Anew.
56, Lawrence Taylor. Just want to say shout out.
Did it just for you, Chip. This is the one.
It was meant to be, dude.
Hey, yeah, okay. Mission accomplished. Thank you, guys.
Oh, yeah.